Hello, I'm Jack Rickard, and this is Electric Vehicle Television. It's been a while. I'm getting inquiries from all over the world. What happened to your blog and video? We recently had a bit of a EVCon, Electric Vehicle Conversion Convention. I had canceled it. About 50 people showed up anyway. And we had a whole event for the week here at EVTV. It went very well. I had originally, the first EVCon, that's what I had envisioned. And that's what we did this time. It was a lot more relaxed, a lot more focused and tightly focused on electric vehicles and particularly the controller area network and the work we've been doing with the EVTV hack team and reverse engineering modern electric vehicles to develop OEM components that we can repurpose for the purposes of your builds. The last 6 weeks or a month, I have kind of been run over by orders while at minimal staff, and they're kind of an international nature, and much more, I would characterize them as prototype efforts or fairly serious efforts at some version of an electric vehicle, some of them for military, for off-road use, for buses, various experiments, and boats and things that are, I would call it a step change above your hobbyist building a electric Miata in the garage with a Costa motor. And apparently some of our work with OEM components has attracted their attention. So I've been kind of up to the belt buckle with international shipping issues and fairly large orders for 3, 5, or 8 volt chargers or Delphi DC to DC converters to Spain, the United Kingdom, Germany. It's been kind of inundated with that. At the same time, I continue to my first love at this part. Point is C++ and CAN hacking and OEM components, and most particularly the Tesla drive unit. And so I've been a little bit buried, and we're kind of at a point where we're doing what Jack wants to do every day, and some days that's not do a video. We will continue the videos, of course. It's the central, it's what I am basically as a publisher. Not really into product development, but I have been distracted by this new direction, and I kind of see where that goes in the future, and I think it's part of the next evolution in electric vehicles. Certainly are part of it. You know, it will continue with the manufacturers, but as I had warned you or had reported more than warned, we're in a season of discontent over electric vehicles. This is a dark period that I think we'll get through. But the low cost of gasoline is somewhat of an effect, and I don't want to underestimate that. More so, it is the kind of what you get caught up in obsolescence of a rapidly emerging technology. And what we've seen is some incredible, depreciation situations with some of the existing OEM cars whose sales have never, frankly, lived up to the manufacturer's expectations, with probably the lone exception of the Tesla. The value proposition has struggled. Right now here in Cape Girardeau gasoline is like $1.99 a gallon. So what the result has been, I've got some figures year over year that are kind of interesting. I'm going to include one that I don't normally simply because it's so stark, and that is the Toyota Prius plug-in hybrid vehicle. And sales of that vehicle from January to September of 2014 compared to January to September of 2015 are down a whopping 58%. Sales of the Nissan Leaf, for example, during that same period, January to September 2014 to 2015, are down 38%. And sales of the Chevy Volt during that period are down 36%. There is the, not to ignore Ford, the Ford Fusion Energy from 2014 to 2015 is down 35%. The only exception, and understand that the sales in 2014, the sales had never reached expectations for the Nissan Leaf, for the Chevy Volt, for the Toyota Prius plug-in, or for the Ford Fusion Energy. But they're particularly discouraging over the past year. The lone exception is Tesla Model S, which continues to be panned by critics in the Seeking Alpha and so forth. People seem to take great sport in trash-talking Tesla. They're up 52% for the same period. And so while essentially all the makers of electric vehicles, OEM of electric vehicles, are suffering a sales dip of over a third, 35, 36, 38%. Tesla enjoys a growth of 52% while they're selling a car that's at the very high end of the scale. Mine was over $100,000. The Volt, the Leaf, the Ford Fusion are all down in the $30,000 range, where supposedly they would be having excellent numbers. They sell no more cars unit sales than Tesla does, and now their percentages are down dramatically while Teslas are up. Tesla, this month, has done two things. One, they rolled out their Tesla Model X at the end of September, September 29th, I believe. Let's take a look. I've got some video of that.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Elon Musk.
Hello. Testing one, two. All right. All right. Welcome everyone to the Model X launch. So, thank you all for coming. The Tesla team has worked incredibly hard. They've done, I think, an amazing job, and I'm really looking forward to showing you the car. I want to start off just by reminding people like what the, you know, the mission of Tesla is: to accelerate the advent of sustainable transport. as I think you guys know, it's incredibly important that we move to a sustainable world sooner rather than later. The sooner we do it, the better it is. And it's important to show that that any type of car can go electric. We showed that you could make a compelling sports car with the Roadster, and that could go electric. And we showed that you could do it with a sedan, and now we're gonna show that you can do it with an SUV. So we're gonna start off with what's actually most important for a car, which is safety. So if you're driving, you're carrying your friends and family around, there's really nothing that's more important than safety. So first and foremost, the car's gotta keep you and the ones you love safe and protect you under any circumstance you can imagine. So. So there you have the Model X. I'm going to talk a lot more about the details of the car, but I'm going to start off with safety. So with the Model X, we've created the safest SUV ever. It's the first SUV that's 5 stars in every category. So, and I thought I'd just... explain what does 5 stars mean? Because 5 stars is not technically a statistical number. It's sort of a rough reference point. And what it actually means is it describes the probability of a serious injury in a high-speed accident. So you start off with sort of 2-star, 3-star, 4-star, 5-star, and they go down in 5% increments. So a 4-star would be a 15% probability of injury in a high-speed accident. 5-star would be 10%. Hypothetically, if there was a 6th star, it would be at 5%. And we've been able to get with the Model X an expected rating of about 6.5%. So. And so let me explain how we get to such a low probability of injury. It goes to the design of the car and the fundamental architecture. So starting off with the frontal, what happens in a frontal crash. This is where most injuries and deaths occurs in a frontal crash. And normally with a gasoline car, you've got a large steel engine block in front. And so in a high-speed impact, that engine block compresses into the passenger compartment and obviously causes damage to the people that are sitting there. With the Model X, there is no such thing. So we have a small electric motor that's down low by the battery pack. And the net effect is that you've got a much larger distance for the crumple zone. So it's really taking impact energy is about force over distance. And if you've got a longer distance, you can actually distribute that force over that longer distance and have a better deceleration and not impact the cabin. So in the case of the frontal zone, you've got you've got something that's the equivalent of, like if you were to jump out of a tall building into a pool, it's the difference between jumping into a pool or a pool with a rock in it. So you don't want the pool with the rock in it. So then going on to a side impact. The Model S and the Model X are about half of the next best in the SUV class. So the X is the side pole intrusion is only 215 millimeters in the Model X, and that's compared to the next best SUV, which is about double that number. And let's see what that looks like in pictures. So this is what it looks like with a side. This is the actual side pole test for the Model X compared to the next best SUV in the world. Yeah. I mean, this is the difference between life and death. This is a really big difference. So, and then now let's look at the rollover numbers. So the Model X, because it has a low center of mass with the battery pack and the floor pan, has half the rollover propensity of any SUV or minivan. So the probability of a rollover injury is substantially reduced. And you can see this in the architecture. We start with the pack, and that pack provides a stiffening member for the whole car. It provides a very strong foundation for the whole car, lowering the center of mass, and serving as a load transfer medium to the rest of the vehicle. So whereas a gasoline car really just has thin corrugated sheet metal at the base and can't transfer the load in a side impact. So we'll just show you the rest of the car building up. You see the motors and the chassis. It gives you a sense for the core architecture of the car. Now, of course, the best protection is not to get into an accident at all. So the Model X comes standard with active safety, which includes automatic emergency braking and side collision avoidance. So the car will actually use the camera and the radar to automatically brake before there's an accident, and it will use the ultrasonic sensors around the side of the car to steer you away from a side collision. And these are active all the time, and it's just a standard feature in the car. Now the third thing, which is sort of topical, is air safety. Now we designed the car well before recent events. So it just happens to have, there's recent events have illustrated the importance of air safety. And we have with the Model X the first true HEPA filter in a car. So why is it important to have a particulate filter? Why is it important to have a gas filter in the car? It's because this translates to a real change in life expectancy. So these are the most conservative numbers we could find on the internet, like the most conservative. They go way worse than this. This is basically the least bad thing that would happen if you lived in these cities. So, and now let's take a look at the filters themselves. I want to show you just how much of a difference this is. The top one is our primary air filter. The one on the left and the bottom is our secondary air filter. The one on the right is a normal car air filter. I think we've got some of those here. So this is what a normal car filter looks like. It's really, really quite small. This is the primary air filter of the Model X. And this is the secondary air filter. Our secondary air filter is bigger than the primary air filter of a typical car. So not only is it 10 times larger area, but the quality of the filter is greater. So that translates to a several hundredfold improvement in the filtration capability. It is 300 times better at filtering bacteria, 500 times better at allergens, 700 times better at sort of smog, and 800 times better at filtering viruses. And this is on a bad day. So this is the minimum passing grade when it's just operating and it's at its worst. In addition to the particle filters, we have three layers of active carbon. So we've got one universal adsorbent layer, that's the initial layer. Then we've got another activated carbon layer that's meant for acid gases, and another one for alkaline gases. The net effect of the air filtration system is that you have air cleanliness levels which are comparable to a hospital operating room in the car. And in fact, when the car is operating at its at maximum capability, so if you sort of press max capability in the car, we can't even detect any viruses or bacteria or spores. So it's like zero come through. So if there's ever sort of an apocalyptic scenario of some kind, hypothetically, you just press the bioweapon defense mode button. This is a real button. So what? Yeah, we're trying to be a leader in apocalyptic defense scenarios. So let's move on to the car itself. Like, what's cool and fun about the car? Doors and windows. Okay. So, you're obviously familiar with the Falcon Wing door. What we also have is an auto-presenting front door. So, it'll triangulate my position and detect that I am moving towards the front door. It will open the front door without me touching anything. I will sit down and it will close the door, like an invisible chauffeur. Yeah. And there are a few other features that are hard to demo in this exact scenario, but something that we worked very hard on is a windshield that's a panoramic windshield, so it comes up and over and feels like a helicopter cockpit when you're driving. So it gives you unbelievable visibility. It's transformative in the driving experience. So you really, when you do the test drives later tonight, you'll see what I mean. It's really, really makes a difference. And then in addition to that, we also have a small feature, but an important one, is the ability to blind holster your phone. So this is like one of those things where it's small, but it's important. Instead of having to fiddle with a bunch of wires to plug in your phone, you can basically take it out of your pocket and blind holster it. It'll automatically fit, and there are adapters for every variant of popular phone. So, let's open these doors. So the reason we created these doors was we were trying to solve a problem, which is how do you access the third row if you have child seats in the second row? I encountered this problem when I first got a gasoline SUV and I had twins, and once you put them in the second row, you couldn't access the third row. So we wanted to have an opening that was big enough so that you could do that. So you could have real utility of the third row, while even if you have kids seats in the second row. So you basically just press the button, the seats will go forward, and I can step directly in. So. It's also important that if you have, say, a child seat here, that instead of having to cantilever your kid out in front and sort of put them basically into a small hole, you can actually just stand right here. You can actually step into the car if you want, and you can just put your child down in the child seat. It makes a huge difference in terms of back strain and comfort. So. Those are the two functional reasons, and it also looks cool. So, yeah. So that's the Falcon Wing doors. And now, obviously a question with the doors is, so how do they fit in tight spaces? Well, we'll show you. Let's bring out the cars. So the scenario we're going to show you here is if you've ever been in a parking lot and someone parked real close. So that it's, I don't know if you can see well here, but there's only about a few inches separating the side mirrors on each side of the car. So we're going to open the Falcon Wing doors when there's barely enough room to squeeze between the two cars. The reason it's able to do that is because, unlike a traditional gullwing door, which is only actuated on a single hinge, the Model X Falcon Wing doors are actuated on two hinges. So it's able to move up and over instead of simply moving out in a broad arc. And moreover, if you compare it to, say, a minivan door, let's open the minivan door here. You can see that when the minivan door opens, I can't even get through that space. So let's close the minivan door. Now the Falcon Wing door is open. So our goal was to create an aperture that was more functional than a minivan door, and I think the team has succeeded. So I think it's the best aperture out there. And just to illustrate what it's like in a garage, so you saw what it's like if it's tight from a side standpoint. Well, what if you have a low garage? That's one of the most common questions I get about the Model X. The car actually automatically senses what the roof height is. So there are ultrasonic sensors in the roof of the car that calculate the roof height and automatically compute a new opening arc depending upon what the height of the ceiling is and what the side obstacles are. We actually developed a new ultrasonic sensor that's able to do sonar through metal. So in order to avoid having a puck, which is ordinarily needed for ultrasonic sensors, we thought the aesthetics of the puck would not be good to be because it would have to be in the center of the door. So we actually developed an ultrasonic sensor that can literally see through metal. All right. So let's... maybe talk a bit more about the second row seats. So normally second row seats in a car don't get a lot of love, So let's show you what second row seats typically look like in a car. So that's sort of what second row seats normally look like. But when we're, particularly when you open something and it's silhouetted as it does with the Falcon Wing door, it tends to create a halo around the seat. So we put a lot of effort into creating a beautiful seat. And not only is the seat, I think, probably the best looking second seat, if that's a superlative, ever, but it actually provides more functionality because you have a flat floor and you can stow if something. So if you've got a backpack or a laptop or a handbag, you can stow that under the seat instead of having it at your feet. So it actually provides utility as well as aesthetics. All right. And speaking of utility, let's see what the Model X can really carry. The Model X is capable of towing 5,000 pounds. So 5,000 pounds while carrying 7 people and quite a lot of luggage. Yeah. And of course, let's not forget about the frunk.
Where's the stroller?
Yes, we need the stroller. There we go. Do you want to put them in or do you want to carry them out? All right. All right, so there you have it. Model X carrying seven people, a 5,000 pound trailer, and I lost count of how many bags, and a stroller. All right, so something that we developed for the Model X is, like, let's say you want to carry skis, bikes, and you want to do that quickly and easily. We made an accessories hitch that can be put on by a kid in approximately 10 seconds. Thank you. I think that was more like 5 seconds. So the accessories hitch can carry up to 4 bikes or up to 6 sets of skis. And you can close the trunk and have full functionality with the rest of the car. Skis and snowboards, indeed. And then the final element, of course, is performance. So even the standard version of the Model X has quite high performance. So it's got the standard version 90D's got 257 mile range, all-wheel drive, of course, and it gets to 60 miles an hour in 4.8 seconds. And then the P90D Ludicrous mode. I mean, this goes so fast, it's wrong. Do 0 to 60. This is an SUV, and it'll do 0 to 60 in 3.2 seconds. All right. So with that, let's hand over the first production cars. All right. All right, so let's see, VIN 6. Hey, all right. What's up, man?
Amazing. Hey.
Congratulations, such an awesome job.
All right, cool. Nice license plates. All right.
Great work.
All right. All right, it's VIN 5. Car's coming soon. All right.
Thank you very much.
See? Is it okay? Hopefully the call will be sick here soon. All right, thanks. All right, and VIN 4. Standing for Sergey. All right. VIN 3. All right. Good to see you.
Congratulations.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Hey. Congratulations. Thank you. All right, and VIN 2. All right. Yeah, man. Yeah. All right. And then, let's see. Then the final one is my car, which is going to be up in a moment. And I will leave up. I'll leave that my car on stage when it arrives so that you can come and take a close look at it and call around it and that kind of thing. And that's that, really. I hope you have a great night. Enjoy the test drives. Thank you, and thank the Tesla team who worked super hard to make this night work. All right, thanks, have a good night.
At the center of every successful entrepreneurial organization is a detail-obsessed, obsessive-compulsive autocrat, sometimes referred to as an asshole, who's just totally obsessed on details. If you don't know who that is in your organization, it's probably you. But if there's any doubt who it is at Tesla, I just couldn't hardly stand watching Elon Musk play with the rear seats. This is a man who obviously has 5 children and is building a car. And he's kind of all over the details of it. I thought the Model X is a tour de force introduction. The Falcon doors look fantastic. The panoramic windshield, I think, is something that is going to have to be experienced to truly appreciate. And I found the HEPA air filter, a monster air filter, just an absolutely inspired touch. That said, the one disappointment with Tesla is the value proposition. The Tesla Roadster was purported to be $109,000, when it actually came time to deliver, it quickly became $125,000. But we were assured that life would be better with a Tesla Model S, which would be introduced at a price of $55,000. My Tesla Model S was $106,750, and I don't have the panoramic sunroof. In fact, there's a number of things I don't have. The next fish in the barrel was to be the Model X. It would be less money, and it's coming in at more money than the Tesla Model S. The talk now is of the Tesla Model 3 at $35,000. Would anybody care to enter a side bet at how many $35,000 Model 3s are ever built? I'm going to put down my best guess at zero, because Mr. Musk is a man who has done some brilliant things, and I'm a big fan of, but he has an absolutely consistent, nay, I would say religious affiliation with price and delivery dates, in that he has never met either one time in a row. And so I find the Model X a little pricey, but a gorgeous car, and I think it's going to have an incredible effect. Ironically, one of the impacts of the introduction of the Model X would appear to be an increase in unit sales of the Model S sedan. This is a little bit counterintuitive, but apparently there were a significant number of people waiting on the fence to see the introduction of the Model X. I can't believe any of them are disappointed in it, but they may be somewhat put off by the delivery lag time, which could be, you know, up to a year. The ramp up that was supposed to be much faster than the Model S is apparently suffering to some degree, and it's doubtful that Tesla will meet their 50 to 55,000 unit sales during the calendar year. That said, I think partially simply that the question is answered. Here's the Model X, and it'll be a while before you can get one. A lot of people that were sitting on the fence have decided to go ahead and purchase a Model S. I think part of the play there is that Tesla has been fairly successful with their certified pre-owned program and their trade-in values, and I think a lot of people are thinking they can buy now and trade up to a Model X later. And that's not a bad strategy. And so that's the other interesting thing or occurrence this week that I think has been actually kind of a blunder, has been the introduction of version 7.0 of the Tesla operating software. And it's certainly messed up my car. We've had to reboot the whole center console instrument panel a couple of times since this upgrade has occurred. And my car isn't really equipped, being kind of a early 2013 model, hasn't been very well equipped to take advantage of the autopilot, auto drive, whatever you want to call it. It doesn't have all the hardware to do this. The auto drive shows up in a couple of areas. It's got an automatic lane changing function. It will follow a track, the lane down the road, and it will auto park. The most interesting aspect of it is that it kind of reports your position and your route and what the car does to do this. With a number of them out there, Tesla will very quickly gather an enormous database of actual driving experience on actual roads that over time should be the basis to vastly improve this. All that said, and there have been people drive across country already on the autopilot features, the reports of auto parks that won't park and lane following that didn't follow the lane are sufficiently numerous to put the whole thing under a cloud. Elon Musk has repeatedly warned us of the dangers of artificial intelligence. I can only warn him of the dangers of auto drive concepts. I am not a big fan of it. Sure, I'd like to be able to take off down the highway and turn the car loose to follow the lane and maybe do a little reading on the internet and check out some email and so forth. That would sure make traveling go faster and have less stress and so forth. And I actually do believe that a computer is capable of driving a car much more safely than I am. All things being in a perfect world, unfortunately, we're driving in a very imperfect world, and I'm not convinced that that this is going to work. I am concerned that it shifts the legal responsibility for an accident from the driver to the manufacturer, and I'm surprised that so many people looking at this with such enthusiasm. I suppose it is an interesting and neat technology, but I'm not sure just what that does. Apparently, Mr. Musk has paid attention to that. He's talking very carefully about it being an autopilot-type feature, much like in an airplane, assisting a pilot to reduce his workload, not really flying the plane for him or taking responsibility for the flight. That's the right way to think about this. In that vein, kind of a cruise control for steering, I'm on board, but I apparently they don't have it quite ironed out yet. Recall I reported some Idaho National Test Lab data on the Nissan Leaf, comparing their fast charge to their regular charge and the impact on batteries over time. They have done another project. And it's kind of interesting. There's about 160,000 gas stations in the country, and there is kind of a naive view that in order to make electric cars viable, we have to duplicate that with charging infrastructure. And in fact, many people count the reason electric cars haven't taken off is because of the lack of charging infrastructure. I have tried to explain or point to that this is not the case for several years. There are some infrastructure issues or some plays that can make electric cars more interesting to a few more people. And that is being addressed with Tesla's smart charge network, I think, fairly brilliantly. However, as we've said, our observation has been people get a new electric car, manufactured car, or one that they build, and the first thing they do is go out and find a public charging station and plug into it to charge on free electricity, and it's a great thrill to do so. For about 20 or 25 minutes, at which point it's kind of like watching Jack test batteries on video on Sunday night. It's akin to watching paint dry. And so they unplug, drive off, and in many cases never plug into a public charge station again. Of course, there's always the guys trying to drive an electric car across country. That's not precisely what electric cars are for at this point, but God love you, go for it. The Idaho National Test Lab did some very interesting things in conjunction with, they call it the EV Project and the Charge Point America Project, two projects, and combined these form the largest plug-in electric vehicle infrastructure demonstration in the world, running between January 1st, 2011 and December 31st, 2013. This project installed about 17,000 level 2 charge stations and 100 dual port fast charge stations in 22 regions across the United States. And they would actually go to people and offer to put a EVSE in their garage in exchange for being able to monitor the thing. Now, what's interesting about this study is it has nothing to do with what people report. These surveys and so forth can be notoriously unreliable. People have various biases and agendas and so forth. This is actually monitoring cars and where they charge. And this comprised about 8,000 electric vehicles. There was over 4,000 Leafs, some Chevy Volts, 300 Smart for Twos, electric drive vehicles, some 8,000 EVs total, 125 million electric miles driven, and 6 million charging events. And what did they find out? About 98% of all charging occurs at home. The only public charging receiving any substantive use were the 22 fast charge stations and a handful of level 2 charge stations at unique points, notably airports and commuter parking lots, some downtown parking lots. But in general, the public level 2s were sitting unused. The other interesting thing that came out of this, a couple of things. Leaf drivers drove a little bit less than the national average. Volt drivers averaged only 6% fewer EV miles per year than the Leaf drivers, despite having less than half of the battery storage capacity. There's a couple of reasons for this. The Volt drivers tended to deplete their batteries prior to recharging because, of course, they have the gasoline motor that will then kick in, where the Leaf drivers like to get home with some significant charge left in their batteries. And the Volt drivers tended to plug in more. The interesting thing about this was it was also coupled with the Federal Highway Administration highway statistics of 2013, which we've said for a number of years that the average American drives about 14,500 miles per year, or 39.7 miles per day. The national average has dropped to 11,346 miles as of the end of 2013, or about 31 miles per day. Now, this isn't electric vehicle drivers. This is all drivers. We're simply driving less. The Leaf averaged 9,697 miles per year, and the Volt averaged 12,238, but 9,112 of those were all electric. In other words, 74.45% of all the miles driven by Chevy Volt owners were in electric mode with no gasoline engine running. The Leaf charges at home 84% of the time, away 16% of the time. The Volt charges at home 87% of the time, and away 13% of the time. Overwhelmingly, the away charging was at three or fewer locations, and by far the majority of it was at their place of employment. And so that's the actual facts of charging in an electric car is you charge at home, and you charge at your place of employment, and you'll charge using fast charge when going between cities. And that's about the extent of it. Solar, there's some interesting solar information. This past couple of weeks, New York City's Times Square, Solar City, the nation's largest installer of residential solar panels, and Elon Musk, who's the chairman of their company, introduced what they claim is the world's most efficient rooftop solar panel, achieving a peak efficiency of 22.04%. The rating was verified by the Renewable Energy Test Center, a third-party certification testing provider for photovoltaic and renewable energy based in Fremont, California. Peter Reeve, as Solar City's co-founder and Chief Technical Officer. What the basis of this announcement was is SolarCity is putting up a gigafactory in New York to produce their own panels and drop the cost of those panels thereby. But instead of it being, kind of an amorphous silicon, low-cost venture, these are very high-efficiency, kind of on par with the U.S. SunPower type things, or the panels that we sell here at EVTV. We get basically the SunPower cells from China. We sell them on a 3-millimeter laminate that's very lightweight, 6 pounds. It's all about putting it on the curved roof of an RV or a golf cart or the hull of a boat. And those have been very popular sellers for us. And of course, we have to have high efficiency because there's very limited real estate on the roof of an RV or something. But SolarCity is going a different direction, and this is actually very interesting. It's actually the heart of their franchise, and it goes like this. They will come put solar panels on your roof, and you pay nothing. And you sign an agreement to buy the electricity from the solar installation at a rate slightly below what you pay the local utility. And you sign for this program for a period of 20 years. The advantage, of course, to the homeowner is not only are they living solar, but they're locking in their electric rate at a bit lower price than what they pay the utilities now. And the utilities, of course, are voracious in applying for and receiving increases in their electric rates every year, annually. And so over the course of the 20 years, as the utility rates go up, the rate you'll be paying for the electricity from the solar panels on your roof will be locked in at the same level. And at the end of the 20 years, you can have it upgraded to newer panels. And of course, in the meantime, if you sell the home, that passes to the new owner, and they gain the advantage of it, and so it increases your property value substantially in most cases. And you're out nothing and don't have to deal with the financing. And so SolarCity is kind of a financing operation, but what it winds up being is a utility company. They are competing with the local utility to sell you electricity. They're using your roof to do it, but they're panels. And this is kind of interesting because there is a considered movement right now, verging on a war breaking out, funded by the Koch brothers and the Edison Electric Institute, who are teaching utility companies that individuals with solar panels on their roofs are the enemy and threaten their business model. I don't think they inherently do. I think there's a lot of natural cooperation there, largely because the peak demand for electricity tends to be in the afternoon, early evening, when these solar installations are producing the greatest, and the very lowest time of electric demand is 3 a.m. in the morning when these solar installations are not producing. And so it would appear that there's a natural alliance, but the fossil fuel industry basically is funding heroic efforts to convince the utility companies that the solar is their enemy. It's just a crazy turn of events. There is an exception, however. Tucson Electric Power is attempting to basically mimic the SolarCity function by renting customers' roofs for solar panel installation. They first proposed this in August of 2014. It fixes the utility bills of participants at their current level for the next 25 years, which Tucson Electric figures the lifetime of the panels. And their plans to accept 500 participants in this program in 2015. This is kind of the thing. Their rate out there is 12 cents per kilowatt hour, which is about the national average. But a current TEP customer paying $100 per month uses 852 kilowatt hours per month. Person paying $240 a month uses about 2,044 kilowatts each month. If the increases and usage of those two typical customers remain the same, the $100 per month customer would save about $20,000 over the 25 years. The $240 per month customer could save $50,000. So basically, if you'll let Tucson Electric put panels on your roof, they'll lock in your rate for 25 years. Very similar to the Solar City thing. Coming to electric vehicles, my original interest was actually the batteries. And actually, that was kind of a corollary to something I was even more interested in, which at that time we called photocatalytics. Photocatalytics is now kind of more talked about as the hydrogen revolution or hydrogen evolution reaction, HER. The basis of all this is there's about enough energy that falls on the Earth from the sun in an hour to power all of human civilization for a year. And of course, we know that plants are very good at using this energy. They basically take water and sunlight and make carbohydrates. And that's the basis of food on our planet. If you stop that process, the world comes to an end. This is done using hydrogenase enzymes, but the search has been on for a simulation of that using inorganic compounds. Discovered by Shell Oil Company, coincidentally, in 1977, a relationship between platinum as a catalyst and titanium dioxide indicated that the titanium dioxide would release oxygen ions, and that would release hydrogen at the catalyst or platinum. And this is kind of the reverse of this is sort of the basis of the fuel cell that combines oxygen and hydrogen to produce electricity. We used to call this photocatalytics. It involves sunshine, water, and a catalyst. And the catalyst was platinum, unfortunately, which is extremely expensive. And it's a very slow process. It doesn't produce very much hydrogen or very much oxygen very quickly. And largely because, at least with the titanium dioxide, it uses a very narrow band gap of the available frequencies in sunshine. And so it's not a very efficient process, but it's a free process. Imagine if we could simply expose water to sunlight and some magic rocks, and they would make hydrogen at one rock and oxygen at the other without any electrolysis as we know it, or the use of any secondary energy source. And so it's kind of magic, platinum being very expensive. A Sandia team has developed a process of doing this by mixing molybdenum disulfide, or MOS2, processing it with lithium to make a very exposed edge type surface, a high surface area material. and have gotten four times as much hydrogen out of that as they had previously, and starting to approach platinum as a catalyst. And molybdenum disulfide is dirt cheap, where platinum is $1,400 an ounce or higher. And so part of the process of mastering this hydrogen evolution reaction, or what I term photocatalytics, the use of light and water to make hydrogen, is lower cost catalyst. And they seem to have had a breakthrough there of some import using molybdenum disulfide. They published a paper on this recently, and you might want to chase that down. The author was Stan Chu, C-H-O-U, with Brian Kerr, K-A-E-H-R, at Sandia National Labs. And that's in Nature Communications 6, article number 8311, 2015. Another study, published 6 October 2015, is about a marine cyanobacteria that produces hundreds of millions of tons of hydrocarbons annually in the oceans. What's interesting about this is the two most abundant of these, Prochlorococcus and Senecococcus, produces more than 2 million tons of hydrocarbons in the ocean at any one time. But there's some co-bacteria apparently eat the hydrocarbons. And this is kind of tied in with an observation from the Exxon Valdez spill and now the BP solar spill in the Gulf. The environmentalists were claiming that there would be a environmental impact for 1,000 years or for 100 years. Actually, 3 or 4 years later, you can hardly find any sign of the damage. And it's basically because these very numerous bacteria in the ocean that eat oil. The other thing that strikes me about this is the entire explanation of how oil was formed in the Earth's crust by dinosaurs and dead leaf matter and so forth, like coal, has never struck me as properly true. A lot of it's very deep, and how it got there, how the dinosaurs got that far down in the rock, has always been an interesting thing. This concept of bacteria that basically synthesize hydrocarbons from, again, water and the sun in vast quantities in our oceans, which the bacteria then die and fall to the bottom, of course, forming layers, points to kind of a limitless amount of fossil fuel. If that's the way they were formed, instead of a few dinosaurs falling down on top of each other and making a layer. And so I like this information about cyanobacteria, both those that produce and those that consume, because it's a whole ecosphere about basically fossil fuels that are fossils at the bacteria level rather than at the brontosaurus level. Lisan researchers have developed an energy-dense lithium metal-free lithium sulfur battery, and Volkswagen is the automotive partner in this. It was an EU-funded 3.7 million euro study, the lithium sulfur super battery exploiting nanotechnology project, and they claim that they have come up with a lithium sulfur battery that uses sulfur carbon composite at the cathode and lithiated silicon at the anode to make a battery with three times the energy density of the current batteries. The project was completed in August of 2015, and They have declared victory, and a good time was had by all. Honda, in addition to making cars, has made generators for a long time. Around here, they're very popular because they're small generators, look like a little sewing machine, and they're very quiet. Now the company is applying that expertise in a new way, turning electric vehicles into the ultimate portable generator. And what they're doing, they're calling it a Honda Power Exporter 9000, and this is being introduced in Japan's SeaTac show. And it has a CHAdeMO plug that plugs into like your Nissan Leaf and then takes power from directly at a DC level from your 400-volt power pack, DC power pack, and converts it to 240-volt AC for use in your house. And that car can power your house for some time. And so this Exporter 9000 is a brand new program from Honda. Volkswagen is kind of gradually coming around to my concept that they turn the VW brand into a all-electric concept. But they've always done a lot of press releases about electric cars without ever actually doing it. That continues. They have announced an all-electric Volkswagen Phaeton sedan is in the product pipeline. Has a 500-kilometer range, and the future generation will be the flagship over the next decade. They also have a commercial called A Moment of Silence. Let's have a moment of silence for Volkswagen, because they may not be with us for very much longer. Let's take a look at this. Chevy Volt and the Nissan Leaf. We have described the cratering of electric vehicle sales this year and the enormous number of vehicles coming off lease. And I had talked of part of the reason for the declining sales was the September release of the new models. The 2016 Chevy Volt was announced to be available in September, and the 2016 Nissan Leaf as well. I actually near enough predicted that that wouldn't happen, that they would be rethinking the introduction of new vehicles, given the number of unsold 2015s and a huge number coming off lease from the 2012s. And it sounded pretty radical at the time. It is October 23rd today, and there are no Chevy Volts and there's no Nissan Leafs out there. The 2016 Nissan Leaf is talked about as if it is here and ready to go, but there aren't any. And similarly with the Chevy Volt, minuscule numbers in a couple of compliant states, and basically none to show. But the conversation continues, and the Chevrolet recently had a big show. Let's see, what are they calling that? October 1st at their annual global business conference, Chevy talked about the Chevy Bolt. And the BOLT Bolt, and LG Chem is the supplier. Became apparent in this was a couple of things. One, shockingly, Chevrolet talked about the cost of the batteries, and noted that they are currently, for the Chevy Bolt for 2016, going to be $145 per kilowatt hour, and that will decline to about $100 per kilowatt hour as of 2022. Now, what's the problem with that? This is great news. Well, not for LG Chem. You see, LG Chem has been trying to sell batteries to Volkswagen and to BMW and to Audi, and but at $100 higher than the $145 price. And so they're furious with Chevrolet for announcing the price of the batteries that are going into the Bolt. Why would LG Chem provide General Motors with batteries $100 cheaper than they are to everyone else? Well, the reason is LG Chem wants to change their line of business. Let's see. The battery maker has invested about $250 million in research and development between LG Chem, LG Innotech, LG Display, and LG Electronics, and a manufacturing facility based in Incheon, Korea, to support component development and manufacturing of Bolt EV components. And the list of things that they're actually providing in the Chevy Bolt explains why GM introduced this 200-kilometer car with such confidence. It's basically not their car. The lithium battery cells and battery pack are made by LG Chem. The battery heater is made by LG Chem. The electric drive motor to be built from a GM design will be built by LG Chem. The power inverter module to convert DC to AC to run the motor will be developed by LG Chem. The onboard charger will be supplied by LG Chem. The electric compressor for climate control system is going to be provided by LG Chem. The high power distribution module, the accessory low power module, the power line communication module, which is for DC quick charging station, all will be produced by LG Chem. The instrument cluster will be produced by LG Chem. The infotainment system will be produced by LG Chem. Basically, LG Chem is providing the batteries at cost in exchange for providing all the components in the electric car that are electric. And they aim to become one of the largest suppliers of OEM components for electric cars. This is fascinating to me, of course, because we're going to have to reverse engineer all those, and it sounds like LG Chem will be providing those to another, their plan would be to provide those components to numerous other automotive manufacturers and be kind of the common component supplier for electric cars to numerous electric car companies or companies making electric cars. So there's some great news about the batteries going towards $100 a kilowatt hour. Let's see, where are we at? Our Chinese cells, we sell at roughly $400 per kilowatt hour. about $12,000 will get you a very nice battery pack. If that was a quarter of that, you're talking about $3,000 or the cost of a set of lead acid cells. Within 7 years, you'll be having a significant lithium pack capable of taking you a couple of hundred miles for the cost of what we were paying for lead acid batteries when all this started, about $3,000. So this is all good news. But even more so is it would be great to have component manufacturers where we had common components between the Ford, Chevy, BMW, and so forth, where a charger was basically a charger, like Lear provides them now to did the charger in the Coda, did the charger in the Smart, and did the charger in the Chevy Volt. So I like the whole talk there. Here's an interesting one. James Dyson is a vacuum cleaner honcho. He has developed the Dyson vacuum cleaner and made a fortune. It's a bagless tornado vacuum cleaner, the most high-tech vacuum cleaner. They spent a couple $100 million on their digital motor and so forth to make this super vacuum cleaner. There's another group that I've been watching kind of intently, although they're very secretive and they've been quite private, and they're called Sacti 3. And Sacti 3 is in Michigan, and they're main claim, there's a woman, I don't know if I've got her name here, but she has been very effective out talking up the solid-state lithium battery. And they started using some equipment to make batteries that was not so much like Intel's lithographic process, more like printing bread wrappers, metallized things on plastic bags and so forth. So very low-cost type processes for making solid-state batteries with solid electrolytes. That has the potential to dramatically increase the density and the life of lithium batteries. And so I've said all along that while we talk about lithium air batteries, aluminum air batteries, lithium sulfur batteries, silicon and the anode and so forth, the real heart of it is our electrolytes sort of suck. And if we could get away from the wet chemical cell and get into a solid state battery, that all of the processes in an ionic battery, there is no real chemistry. There's no chemical changes. It's ions moving back and forth between crystals, and there is some physical deformation, but that can all be controlled. And so basically you're talking about putting down materials using processes very similar to building solar panels or computer processors. And so that's a very interesting area. The problem has been the electrolyte, the transfer agent where the ions pass from the cathode to the anode and back and separate them, insulate them electrically where there's no electron current flow, but you can have lithium ion flow, and that's the critical part. Sacti has been doing it. Dyson paid $90 million. Oh, Anna Marie Sastry is the woman's name that's been appearing on all the discussion panels and so forth about lithium batteries, and has carries a very good story about Sacti. Dyson had put $15 million in the company 3 months ago. They've just paid $90 million and bought the rest of it. So it looks like it's going into vacuum cleaners, but there's a possibility that Dyson wants to get into technology in a little bit wider sense. So that's an interesting thing. Here's a little video. Stanford builds an electric DeLorean. They use some Renovo motors and are working on, again, the auto drive. This is a yaw control, so they're doing drifting with a DeLorean electric. Let's take a look at the video.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.
And I'll play behind me a little bit of B-roll of the new 2016 Nissan Leaf. Again, this car does not quite exist. But were it to exist, or were you to be able to buy it, it's got a 30-kilowatt battery in the SV and SL trims and a new range of about 107 miles. They're also sprucing up the warranty where it is 8-year, 100,000-mile battery warranty, guaranteeing at least 9 bars or 70% capacity up to 8 years and 100,000 miles. The SV is going to be $34,200, and the SL is $36,790. They both have quick charge. They also have two chargers on board now for 6.6 kilowatts, so a little bit faster level two charging. A new instrument panel, a 7-inch screen, so forth, some Bluetooth, and it's going to be all pretty gorgeous. But again, some delay on introduction. It did not really roll out in September, and then we're nearing the end of October, and you're seeing test cars and cars going to the press for examination, but they're not really being sold. Nissan is preparing another car for the Tokyo Motor Show of 2015. Their statement is simply, Nissan's future vision of car intelligence and electrification is coming to Tokyo Motor Show 2015. Some speculation that the new electric car is going to be based on the Nissan Lania concept car that they showed in Beijing. And that could be quite interesting. What else do we have? Some guys just don't like spiders. And, you know, you can burn a spider up with a Bic lighter. You probably don't want to do that at a gas station. Let's have a look. That's one dead spider. Stan Cloyd was at our event, but Stan is kind of looking at getting into adapters and so forth for EVs, and he was fascinated by Nick Smith's concept of casting his own adapter. Well, that's kind of interesting in that Nick Smith didn't really do that. He kind of built a mold, but he took it to a friend of his who was in the casting industry and had it cast. Stan wants to build a foundry from scratch using open source plans from a 1937 Popular Mechanics or something. Let's have a look.
Okay. This is Saturday, and near the end of September. Here my foundry has been reassembled. We have the burner still burning too rich, but I'll get a specialist out or change the jet to take care of that. We've melted our aluminum. It took an hour to get this whole darn thing up so hot that it can do the job. We'll zoom in a little bit. Yeah, I don't think we should have that much soot burning outside the dang thing. Down here we have our RW Beckett oil burner. The air jet's open all the way, so I think I may have to go to a smaller fuel jet. Or take this lid and have it core drilled at a joint that has diamond hole saws out to a bigger size. Okay. Down and see what she reads. C. Well, you metric people, you'll figure that out. Now, let's drop an aluminum rod in there and see what happens. We got molten aluminum in there. This could melt. There we go. There we go. It's melting right in. Ooh. There it goes. Right in. Drop another aluminum rod in there. Well, come on. There we go. Dropped it right in there. Get a third rod in there. Yeah, a little oil on that one burning. There she goes. Don't want to burn the glove. Now, here's a aluminum pipe with two elbows. That'll probably about fill that crucible up. A little oil in it. Fit in the stir rod. Ooh, man, it melted that right away. Yeah, burn the rest of the oil out. Okay. Let's see if I can get up closer and get a better view of that. You can't really see it as well as I can. All right. Hope I don't burn my camera up. All right, now let's skim that melt, because there's always some aluminum oxide on top we don't want in our casting. Dross, they call it. Just tap that out. It's a mixture of both all the trash that's in the aluminum and the oxide. Put that in a can and sell it back to the scrappers. Okay, we've got very fluid aluminum now. Of course, it's chilling up on my ladle pretty good. But there's about, oh, I'd say that crucible, it's got about 28 pounds, give or take, of aluminum in it now. And this is all just junk that I've picked up around the house. Cat food cans, Coke cans, aluminum extrusions, old castings, all that stuff. So let's pull back, warmer back up, I'm going to melt some cans. Take her off record. Okay, we're recording. We've got time for her to warm back up. Kill fire. We'll crank up our lid lifter. The old Acme worm screw trick. Crank the lifter up. This lid weighs about 200 pounds with all the fire brick and the iron and the steel and the mechanism, so lifting it off by hand, especially when it's over 1,000 degrees Fahrenheit, is just not an option. And we did put these handles on it out here enough to get it safe to move. Alright, we have our puddle within about 3 inches of the top. See how quickly it will digest this. These castings I salvaged out. They may be die-cast zinc, they may be aluminum. If they're zinc, they'll go really quick. I think they're too big to go in the hole. They have a problem here. Oh, they're going to melt now. Right in the bottom of my furnace. Well, we're done for today. But if you look down in that furnace, boy, she's hot in the bottom. Looks like Hades down there, for sure. Get my little infrared thermometer out again. High temp range. It reads out in centigrade, which I'm kind of not used to. What's it going to say? It's going to say 818 centigrade. It's so hot down in there, I can't even hold it on. 700 to 800 centigrade. You metric types can do the math on that. Here's some screws and bolts I can throw in the melt. They'll digest all by themselves. Won't even have to kick the fire on you. There. Get the skimmer ladle. Put that block in there. Boom, boom. A little fire. Had some oil on it. Made a bubble. Here's some aluminum spacers and screws. Drop them in. Okay. Stir the melt. Skim it one more time before we quit for the night. There we go. Okay, not a bad demo. Got a few problems to fix, but they're getting more and more minor every burn test. Alright. Well, folks, that's it for tonight. See you at the open house. Back up. My diesel fuel tank with your typical household filter. There's the counterweight. I've got a come along on it now. I'm not exactly balanced, but when you're ready to pour the crucible, you can pull the entire top, the lid, and the barrel up so you can get to the crucible and roll it out sideways with a special hand truck I had yesterday.
Gotta love that Stanley. We did give out several awards at our event here this past month. And one of them was to kind of our keynote speakers, Nick Smith and Stephen West of New Zealand, have put quite a bit of money down to establish a fast charging network across New Zealand using some fast charge stations from Tritium, a company in Australia that's done an AC inverter and some things in the past, kind of in very low numbers and somewhat experimentally. We've never been able to quite procure these things. They're always kind of in development, but they are shipping these fast charge stations. And so we gave them an award for, furthering the cause of electric vehicles. Interestingly, while they were here, they received notice that BMW had offered to give them $200,000, €200,000, I think, of support, no strings attached, just to help further their efforts in building a fast charge network in New Zealand. So they seem to be off and running. Steve is on the cover of New Zealand Business Magazine, and they're causing quite a splash with their rollout of fast charging stations in New Zealand. So excellent work. What did I do with my summer vacation? Let's take a look at some of the stuff I have been working on in the back room. It's you may understand what's been going on around here a little bit from this. Let's take a look. All righty then. We are back on the Tesla test bench. Part of our delay in getting out of video here recently has been, I've been obsessing on a number of things. We've been getting a number of overseas orders. They're a little different, more pilot programs than hobbyists. I think this is part of our move to OEM components. The top of the pyramid, the pecking order of OEMs making electric cars is, of course, Tesla. I'm a big fan of my Model S, and I've been kind of obsessing on the Model S test bench and drive units, chargers, battery packs, and so forth. That's left little time for videos. Let's talk about what we have going here. This, of course, is our test bench. Let's get Elon up here where you can see him. Our Elon bobblehead. Had a call from Hollywood. They wanted to use it in a TV. But they, Elon really has the right to publicity over himself. This was kind of a, we took a bunch of photographs, had some Chinese graphics people do this. So it's a little cloudy where it came from. We probably don't have the rights to it. And so they couldn't use it in the TV show. But we use it here on top of the drive unit. Of course, I've got my panel here. We've been having some very intermittent problems with our controller unit. And it turns out this ground strap here on the end of the motor is not entirely a beauty mark. The case actually needs to be grounded or the noise will pretty much wipe out anything. So we've got that grounded now. I've added a couple of units. First, we have gone to the JevQ unit to run the software instead of the little EVTV Dewey board. That was because I needed a couple of CAN bus ports. And of course, we have kind of a DC to DC converter in the JevQ that cleans up the power. We've added our EVIC display. This is Andromeda Interfaces out in San Diego. They are now cohabitating or sharing space with young Hauber. Matt Hauber, if you will recall, was one of our interns, went out to San Diego to start his own thing, teamed up with a guy named Michael Bream, and formed EV West. Well, they've kind of separated, and Hauber has gone out on his own, not so much to sell components as to do conversions, and is doing rather well with them. He's got a new space, a new girlfriend. They're getting married. I think they're having a baby. I'm not sure I'm supposed to announce that yet, but that's all pretty much happening. And but in the space he got, he rented out half of that to Andromeda Interfaces, Brian Gallagher. We carry their unit. They have three versions. One is for the Orion battery management system. One is for the Curtis controller used on the high performance electric vehicle systems. And one is a combo that they did for us that does a little bit of both. This is the display. We're actually going to make a fourth one. Colin Kidder, we have gotten the software development kit from Andromeda, and I passed that to Colin. He's very much at home with Windows, Visual Studio 8, and C Sharp. It's quite a learning curve for me, but right now I'm just kind of buried around here, so I'm struggling for life. I've passed that off to him. I can show you a picture of what it'll look like. It's going to be a similar interface, but with a instrument dial that looks a lot like what's in the Tesla Model S, and some touch screen buttons to increase and decrease regenerative braking, to turn creep mode on and off, a trip meter, and your park, reverse, neutral, and drive connections. So that will be what the interface looks like. Right now I am working with the EVIC combo. EVIC is what they call their electric vehicle interface console or display. Up here on the left, you can see the motor. That's motor temperature. Below that's controller temperature. In the upper right-hand side is ampere hours used and state of charge, and a little battery here that'll show how much battery you have left. A voltage. We have RPM. Let's see what I've got here. And that's displayed here. Now, the EVIC will only display 6,000 RPM. Of course, we need to display more than that, but on the actual display, we'll display more power and miles per hour, which is directly related to RPM because of our single-speed gearbox. So this is not very useful on this display, but I'm trying to work out the CAN codes and so forth back and forth to communicate with the EVIC and check the reaction time of the EVIC and so forth. And then we have two bars across the bottom. One is amperes discharge, which is what you get when you're using current, and amperes charge below that, which is what you show when you have regenerative braking or your charger on. And let me turn on our inverter here on the panel. I'll just press that button. And we get voltage very well from the Tesla drive unit. I have never really found a direct certified current. Now I get torque and I get some things that could be current. It's kind of hard to separate torque and current by guessing. And so there we are. But what I've done is taken a one of our cab 300s. It's a little can current sensor, Hall effect sensor, and put that on the battery. And I think we're going to use that as part of our Tesla control kit. The I can turn on the charger here and see if that comes up. And yeah, we can see we've got plus 7 amps on the EVIC. And I can look on the laptop and see I'm doing about that. And so that's what's going on there. I have also added this PKP2400. This is a PowerKey Pro 2400 button set, and it operates over CAN. And so I can press buttons, and they will cause CAN messages to go to my controller. And I've defined, I don't have these labeled yet, they have little black lenses you can laser inscribe, and I don't have those in. And they have LEDs that you can light, green ones and red ones and amber ones and different blinking patterns, all by control area network messages. And so when I press a button, I get that to the controller, and then the controller lights the corresponding LED. I don't know what the perfect combination of that is just yet. But park, reverse, neutral drive. This is our creep on and off. This one isn't used, and these two are an inker-dinker on our regenerative braking. In the Tesla Model S, you have standard and low regen. And we've decoded how to break that into 256 discrete levels. And that gives us very good control over the regenerative braking. I have it set at 30% now. I can bump this a couple times, 39, 44, 49, 54. I don't have that displayed on here, but we will have on the actual Tesla drive unit version, which we are calling the Alset, capital A-L-S-E-T. Alset is, of course, Tesla spelled backwards. But we're not going to run backwards, and I'll show you why. So I can put on the brake here and press drive and release it, and away we go. And I can press on the throttle, and as we've seen in the past, run it up, and you can see I get a kind of a blast of a regenerative braking here at the bottom. The red numbers, minus 42 or whatever, that's the current I'm using, and that's actual current red with the cab 300 to drive the motor. I'm at 604 RPM. If I press creep off, that's going to drop. And here we can see we're at 330. I've still got all that on my plain ASCII text line, which by now is too long to even view on the laptop. But what we're trying to do is transition to some devices that could be used to run a car. And our initial wag on that will be an EVIC display and this PowerKey Pro button system. Where you can operate it with the buttons and observe the changes on the screen. Eventually, we'll transition this to the more Tesla looking version of the screen. And ultimately, I hope to go to the buttons on the screen to replace the PKP200 or 2400. But that's where we're at right now. I can press reverse, and because I'm at creep off, it actually will reverse. But I can't go very fast in reverse. I can't even make Elon's bobblehead wag in reverse. And that's, as it is in the car, we're limited to about 15 miles per hour in reverse. I can go directly into drive from reverse for some reason without pressing the brake. But normally you have to step on the brake to change gears. And I have a button here on the panel to simulate that brake input into the inverter. Again, the Tesla drive unit, I get a lot of questions about breaking it apart. It is a very integrated system. This gearbox goes all the way to the back. The inverter plugs into that. The motor plugs into this. The coolant goes down the rotor, back out around the stator, down through the controller, and then out through the back of the gearbox and out this hose here. And there's no way to separate this to do something different in a car. It's a preposterous notion. So it's a designed integrated unit, and we're going to use it the way it was designed, of course. And so here we are in forward, and I can run this up. Of course, this shows 6,000 RPM, where I'm going to 16,000 on there, but you can see the regenerative braking coming in here. I do get a voltage display that jumps up when I do that, and it's actually extraordinarily accurate, much more accurate than my JLD 404. And so between the cab 300 and the actual measurement out of the inverter, I do get a very accurate numbers. And eventually we'll have kilowatts for the power side of the Tesla display and kilowatt hours, which is how we'll actually measure instead of amp hours, to establish our state of charge. Again, I can put the regen up. Here, let's go to about 63% is what it comes from the factory. Here's 82. And you can see it just, it's very aggressive. Slows it down really quickly. And this is gonna be a matter of feel, which is why I like making it adjustable. Here's 35% and a much slower thing with less power generated out of it. But you can watch the voltage spike up over 400 when we're doing that. And so this is a little bit of what Jack's been playing with, is doing the software to try to integrate this PowerKey Pro 2400, which uses CAN open. The EVIC display, which has some defined CAN messages that they use, and our controller, which is now in a JevQ box, made up little harnesses and so forth, and the cab 300, and to integrate all that together to work with the harness we've made for the drive unit and the CAN messages that we had previously reverse engineered, and it's all kind of coming together pretty nicely at this point. I think we're going to have an excellent system. It's going to be a little more involved and a little more expense than I had expected or intended. But you know, as you get to one thing, you see an opportunity to do something else that's cool to go along with it. And I'm kind of totally fixated, obsessed, I suppose, on bringing the Tesla drive unit to the market to where individuals can buy these kind of refurbished units. I mean, one of the things we do is change the seals, as you saw on the drive unit itself. We've located those seals that we can use to do the gearbox, and I'm gradually gaining access to more parts, connectors, wiring harness, and so forth. In the end, I envision a harness system and a display, perhaps a keyboard, but an entire harness system with very clear documentation as how to electrically incorporate the Tesla drive unit in your build. And I'm quite excited about that. I think it's the crown jewels of OEM components, and I'm looking forward to some absolutely fabulous cars that people can do using this drive unit. So that's a little bit of what Jack's been doing on his summer vacation. As I say, I remain quite enthusiastic about this. This week we did receive something that I think will further illustrate that. Let's take a look. This is also a Tesla drive unit. However, this one I kind of ordered from a guy who salvages Teslas. And he was somewhat reluctant to do this, but wound up doing it for me at some expense, of course. But this is a Tesla drive unit, but it's in the aluminum superstructure member that it comes with on the Tesla. And in fact, I've got the wiring harness that came with the Tesla and the multi-link, in I suppose independent rear suspension, the wheels, rotors, brake calipers, and actually the wheels that go on the vehicle. So the drive shafts, everything, essentially the whole drive system from the underneath of the rear end of a Tesla Model S. This offers some interesting possibilities. There are four of these hard points, actually rubber isolated mounting positions, that if you could locate those on a vehicle where this was all fairly carefully aligned, you could drop the entire system in under most modern cars. Wheel rim to wheel rim outer edge is 74 inches, and of course wheels extending a bit past the body are not unusual in cars anyway, and so this would be a whole system that you could put in under a car. It also came with some shock absorbers, which are of course kind of large struts, really, that came with it. But these can be used to, you know, mount it, I suppose. Not sure how these go on here, but something like this. And I'm not sure that that wouldn't have to be done something a little bit different. I also got two chargers and a junction box from all this. Here's one of the chargers. As it turns out, there are two charger systems, they call Gen 1 and Gen 2, that appear to be separated pre and post June of 2013. We now have 1, 2, 3, 4 of the Gen 1 chargers and one, perhaps two, but I think one Generation 2 charger. And we've got some plans for that. Mark Weisheimer is going through the can captures on that. Of course, we're fighting the usual issues with connectors, and we'll be trying to marry that in with the concept of the J1702 pilot signal and so forth, which is done in the junction box and charger system. They have a charger and a junction box in the vehicle. The junction box is kind of the magic that lets them do supercharging with very high current DC direct charging to the battery, or at the flip of a couple of contactors in the junction box, charge using these switching power supplies that work off of 240 volts input. And of course, some Teslas come with one charger, most with two, giving them 20 kilowatts of charging power even at home. And so that's how you charge a large battery. And we've got some plans for those. But I thought you might want to see this. One of the interesting characteristics, if you notice on my park reverse neutral drive, there's not really a whole lot of difference as far as the drive unit's concerned with park and neutral. However, for the rest of the car there is, and here's part of the reason, my brake caliper is down here. And of course, here's just a brake line and a mounting clip, and you can hook any brake line into that and work the rear calipers on this wheel. But at the top here, you'll see another caliper, and there's one on each side with an electric solenoid on it. And when you put it in park, that solenoid actually closes that caliper, and that's what gives you your parking brake. There's no handbrake or foot brake or anything for parking in the Model S, but if you put it in park, you are quite locked up, and in fact, you don't want to be trying to tow it with it in park. And that's due to this electric solenoid and separate caliper system. So there's actually two calipers on the rear wheels of the Tesla Model S, an electrically driven one and a hydraulically driven one. The hydraulic is your normal brakes, and the electric is your other thing. So this is kind of an option we're looking at. Instead of mounting this drive unit and making shafts and so forth, we are getting these out of salvage. Why not take the whole structure and do that? And I, in fact, I think there's a middle ground where we could go to internal or independent rear suspension and make the shafts, but actually still use this aluminum structure for the mounting of the motor and gearbox. And so I was quite excited to get this in this week and actually see the original harness work and how it's mounted in the very strong aluminum carriage here, and then the multi-link IRS out to the wheels, and how the rotors and wheels and so forth are fixed. Next week, we're going to make a wooden carriage to carry this on the four mounting points, and where we can wire it up and actually spin the wheels themselves. That'll give us a little bit more load and a little bit more inertia for regen, and we'll further our testing efforts. So I'm going to have Charlie and Preston make up a another wooden carriage like we did for the other one. And so I was very excited to receive this week. I finally have kind of a clear picture in my mind of how all this works under the car, which may surprise you since I have a Model S, but it's kind of all covered up and integrated. I don't want to take it too far apart, maybe not get it back together again. I have difficulty picturing mechanical geometries, and so this is a much needed help. So you can see the, here's the motor end, here's the inverter end, here's your gearbox facing forward, the drive shafts, your multi-link connection to the wheels, here's the upper caliper with the electric solenoid, here's the lower one, and here you have these four rubber isolated mounting points, which next week hopefully I'll get off the pallets and onto some sort of a structure where you can see more clearly how all that works. This is kind of tilted back at the moment on itself, and it's pretty heavy, so I'm not going to pick it up for you, but we will have that mounted more or less level. And I think it'll be very interesting at that point. And so, as you can see, the work continues on exploring and learning about the Tesla Model S drive unit. And I'm confident that within a few weeks or months, we will be able to offer these in several different configurations, allowing you to incorporate them in a build. I've already had several inquiries, actually several here recently, from people with DeLoreans wanting to do something with this, but there's other interests in it, and I think that we'll see some fabulous builds when they can put down a 300 kilowatt drive unit like this. So hopefully that's the direction we'll go, and we should, we're pretty much in the electronic control of it now, and we're trying to work out the configuration of just what that looks like in a car to have a complete set kit consisting of the drive unit, the harnesses, the displays and controls that you'll need to actually implement this in a vehicle. And so that's kind of what I've been working on, along with doing a lot of controllers and stuff for outbound shipments of Delphi DC to DC converters, volt accessory power modules, and volt chargers, which we're moving quite a few of at this point. Stay with us. So as you can see, I'm obsessing on Tesla drive units. We're not pulling in our horns around here precisely. It is a dark period. I've been through those with the development of the internet and other things in the past. Not every day is a day of sunshine. You have to go through quite a bit to get where we're going, and I knew that from the beginning. The commitment of the OEMs has always been a little bit vague and wispy. I've never really put a lot into the concept of a volt or a leaf other than as a source for components for you guys. I think there is going to be a marvelous future of magnetic drive, and I think there's going to be some key players, and I believe Tesla is pretty much the early stakeholder, the 800-pound gorilla in the space at this point. The other players are not really likely to be General Motors. They're not likely to be BMW. BMW could have gotten into it. They kind of showed up too little, too late. I like their carbon fiber approach. Obviously, who doesn't like their engineering? They're a fabulous company. Similarly, Porsche. That's just not going to happen, guys. The Burlington Northern Railroad had all the aluminum and all the design engineers necessary to build and fly and maintain the Douglas DC-3 aircraft. There's a reason why they didn't, and it's a cultural reason. It has nothing to do with their resources or their abilities. And we have that same cultural bridge too far going on here. Tesla is not another car like a Chevy Volt. It shouldn't be viewed that way. Their entire culture, their company, their process of design, of manufacture, of service, of sales, is a different thing. Who are the players of the future? Probably Apple, probably Google, and probably a half dozen companies that I don't have a name for yet, that we don't know about. Along the way, sure, there's a carnage of pioneers, of Azure Dynamics and Coda and Better Place and bad ideas well struck and good ideas ill executed and all manner of mayhem in a bubbling cauldron of technological creativity and innovation. It's the best part of life for me. This is what I love to observe. and it's going to go on into the future, and it's going to be a beautiful future in a lot of ways. I think the adoption of electric drive for personal transportation and ultimately for most transportation very neatly solves dozens of problems in all directions, almost in free-form fashion. And so I'm very much a proponent of it. But the future of it belongs to Tesla, Apple, Google, and dozens of others. Along the tinker and innovator phase, the efforts of the Chevrolet Volt and the Nissan Leaf and BMW and the Bolt and so forth are going to be key aspects of this. That does not mean they're going to be the key players. For us, it's we move into a lane where we're trying to take the sort of proprietary components and commoditize them by reverse engineering their electric language to control them. We can repurpose them for other cars. Well, that empowers people to build a lot better cars. And so what we're seeing at EVTV is kind of a different kind of customer, really. It's not so much the bottom feeders and the DC motor guys. We're hearing from much more sophisticated companies that simply need sources for the cable we carry, or the throttles we carry, or the just some of the little components we've amassed over time, specialty items like the Lim Cab 300 and so forth that are just not in very good supply elsewhere. But we're moving a lot of Delphi DC to DC converters and Chevy Volt accessory power modules and chargers and e-gear drives and that sort of thing. So I think one of the most exciting aspects will be when we can develop the ability to basically deliver an entire Tesla drive unit that you can put in a car with the display and controls and so forth to make the car go. And so, again, this lets individuals and small groups, the two guys in the garage, the small, poorly funded, but interesting development group that's trying to do something new and truly innovative, a drivetrain, a world-class drivetrain, a first-class drivetrain to do that. And so I think that's our future direction and the future direction of all of it. I remain fascinated by and committed to the resurrection of classic vintage cars, heirloom cars, given new life with the electric drive, because I think they are head turners. People love them. They're fun to look at, they're fun to drive, and they showcase this concept of electric drive in a way that's somewhat difficult with a printed by the thousands OEM car that comes offline in any of the three colors you like, as long as it's one of them that they offer. And so they're kind of two different worlds. I'm more into the collector car end of it, and into the a small outfit struggling sometimes through three or four different rises from the ashes, trying to find a place to occupy using their concepts for technology and so forth in the EV space. So it's an exciting time for me. It's a direction we need to go a little bit differently. I, again, say me, I'm not doing most of it. I mean, we've got a whole team of guys around the world involved in developing hardware and software, and I get to kind of put it together and hand it to you. But Colin Kidder and Paulo Alameda and so forth, Mark Weisheimer, Brian Cushane, and Byron Ismenhard, and members of the Hack team are very good about chasing these details to the ground and making it real for you to be able to repurpose these components. When I see LG Chem wanting to be a major player in components, I love the idea, because then we would have more common components. The Chevy Bolt uses this charger, the Ford uses this charger, the BMW uses this charger, and you use this charger. That just makes it a much, kind of levels the playing field where anybody can put together the pieces to make an effective electric car and be essentially on an equal footing with major manufacturers. Chevrolet is basically outsourcing all the parts that matter for the Chevrolet Bolt, and they're going to stamp steel. Okay, stamp away. That's a great idea. Meantime, stay with us. We're not going away, but I turned 60 in July, and I'm doing the best I can between naps. So stay with us, and we'll try to do something else again next week.